Good afternoon, everybody. Before I start the talk, did anybody drop a credit card near the door? Well, now that I have your attention, let's talk about running 400 plus node cluster, no, Cassandra clusters in Azure. My name is Anubhav, and I work for Office 365 at Microsoft. So I'm going to talk about the big picture, our stack, what we built on top of Cassandra and Spark, the challenges that we faced while running this over the last 1 year, how we solved them, and how do we see our path forward. I'll also briefly talk about our contributions back to Cassandra and how you could leverage them in your clusters. So I don't think anybody in this room should require any introduction to Office 365, but I put some numbers up on the slide to give you a sense of scale. So most of the numbers there are in billions and millions, and we are also on a strong growth trajectory, which means these numbers are going to grow further up. So what we want to do is for all of our users, we want to find out if they are happy with 365. Are they fully utilizing the services that they have paid us for? How can we proactively find issues that the users may run into? And do we deeply understand our users over their long lifetime? To solve problems like this, we need three things. We need a system that scales linearly. We need fast data ingestion. And we need real-time as well as non-real-time analytics. So what we did was we built Cassandra clusters. We use version 2.1.13. This runs on Azure Linux VMs. We use Kafka as the intermediate queue. We built multiple clusters to serve needs of different teams and different scale sets. And we have built a common management stack for all of these clusters. And I'll talk about the details of the stack later on. So this is how our architecture looks like. So on the left, you see all the data producers. So these are Office 365 servers and signals coming from your Android or iPhone clients. They are fed to Kafka, and we use Spark streaming to read stuff from Kafka and write to Cassandra. We also use Spark for batch processing to do heavy insights generations. There are two ways we expose this data out. One is through Zeppelin and Splunk. This is for ad hoc exploration. And the other is we have some REST APIs that power specific apps. So let's talk more about the Cassandra side of things. So all of our clusters typically have three rings. We call them analytics, Cassandra, and exploration. The analytics ring does the heavy Spark batch jobs. The Cassandra cluster does the Spark streaming, and it also serves the REST APIs. And the exploration cluster is used for ad hoc querying. We have built this model mainly for separation of concerns. We have around 10 clusters. We run DSC 4.8.5. The biggest one has more than 400 nodes now. It holds 300 plus terabytes of data. And the typical replication factor that we use is 5. Each of these nodes runs Ubuntu Linux 14.x. The SKU is D14. It has around 100 gigs RAMs and 800 gigs SSDs. We do use virtual nodes, G1 garbage collection, and gossiping property file snitch to be rack aware. So let's talk about how we connect these nodes together. So to get high performant networking, Azure has two options, public IPs and private virtual networks. Public IPs are great because they give you geo-redundant replication over internet, but they are not as secure. While VNets give you amazing bandwidth guarantees and low latencies, and they are also more secure. At Office 365, we have very strong security requirements, so we picked VNets for our networking needs. The deployment of these clusters happens through something known as Azure ARM templates. So they are essentially JSON files, as you can see there, where you can make up the layout for your clusters. You can specify how many nodes you want, what type, how they should be connected, and so on. And they also provide extension points, so you can write your custom scripts once this infrastructure is built. So as you can see on the right, you can do all sorts of things to start up your processes, change permissions, and so on. So now let's talk about the interesting stuff. What challenges we faced over the last 1 year, and how did we solve them? So the first and the most interesting one is SSDs can vanish. They give you amazing IOPS and latency, but they are also ephemeral, which means that when nodes move around or when Azure is doing routine maintenance, they'll just vanish. And if they vanish, it means your data is lost. So this will typically reflect as the Cassandra's replace address exception. So you'll have to add that particular tag in the environment shell file and restart the DSC process. The important thing here is you shouldn't forget to remove that line once the node joins the ring. Otherwise, next time around, the node won't be able to join the ring. So we build automation to detect and auto-fix this so that we don't get paged for these kind of problems all the time. The next one is, are you really rack-aware? So Azure provides APIs to figure out the fault domains of the nodes, and we hook into these APIs and get those values and put them into the gossiping property file so that the replicas are placed where we want them to be placed. But again, when Azure moves nodes, they can change the fault domains. So your replicas may not live where you want them to live. Cassandra, for all the good reasons, won't let you change the data center and racks of nodes on the running clusters, which means you have to remove the node and add it back. So again, we built automation to detect and fix these situations. Streaming is extremely slow. So node tool rebuild, or when you are trying to bootstrap a new node, it's going to do a lot of streaming. And it's slow for two reasons. The first is when the node fails while streaming large amounts of data. And remember that our SSDs are 800 gigs, so that's how dense our nodes are. It's going to start from the beginning, which is going to slow down the whole thing. The second big problem is when the source node is transforming SS tables to the target node, it doesn't do that in parallel. It's going to stream one SS table at a time. There are a couple of ways to work around this. So we typically work around this by setting the stream throughput and compaction throughput to the unlimited value, which is zero. You can also play with the TCP keep alive timeouts. That has helped us a lot. But in reality, what we are really waiting for are the two Jiras that I posted there. So the first one will make sure that the SS tables from the source node will go in parallel. And the second one is a bunch of fixes that are some general fixes around the streaming code. So if you don't have them in your version of Cassandra, you should push on the Jira to get it to your version. Heap dumps are very big. So we use 30 gig heaps. So heap dumps are going to be very large on our clusters. Interestingly, the standard Azure OS disk is also 30 gigs, which means that when Cassandra falls apart, it's going to generate this 30 gigs file and it's going to chew the entire disk space and the node will go down. If you are running DataStax Enterprise, it's fortunately easy to fix. So you can edit the DAC script and add the dump file dir line so that the dumps go to a well-known better location. It doesn't go to the OS disk. Or just don't let Cassandra crash. Memory. So on all of our nodes, we run Spark and Cassandra, which means we have interesting memory characteristics. So if you have bad data models or if you're not following good guidelines in your Spark code, it can really easily fill up the 30 gig heap. Now, the interesting thing here is it's not easily discoverable in system logs. So when the Linux kernel finds out that the VM is running low on the memory, it's going to go and find out a process that's taking the maximum amount of memory and kill that process. To figure this out, you can look at the kernel logs and it will clearly tell that it killed the Java process. To fix this, you have to set a low OOM score in the your process's OOM score ADJ file. And if you set this to a value of minus 1000, which is the magic number, the kernel will never pick up your Cassandra process to kill. It will pick other processes. Now, since the PID will change as the DSC process restarts, you need automation around this to constantly monitor and fix this. I don't think compactions require any introduction to this audience. They're IO, very IO heavy, and if you don't set the compaction strategy parameters correctly, it's just a time bomb. At some point, the whole cluster will melt down. One interesting tidbit here is, as compactions are running, they make temp files while they're running, so you will actually need more disk space than what you think you may need. So you need to account for that from the beginning. How to fix it? So we recommend using date-tiered compaction only if you can explain what target class and the get buckets method does, and we can't. So we use the more easy to reason thing, which is size-tiered. It's more easy to reason because then you can figure out how many SS table files for your workload will exist on your disk, and you know if you are seeing odd patterns and stuff like that. Also, pay close attention to metrics like pending tasks, compaction stats, and node tool compaction tasks. Schema updates is another rough area. And here I'm not talking about two people doing schema updates at the same time. I'm just talking about one person doing schema updates. But if nodes are down in big clusters while you're doing schema updates, bad things happen. And the reason it happens is because the CFID for the table changes as you're making some specific schema updates. This is actually very easy to repro in the debugger. the saved caches, subsystem of Cassandra that has maintained in-memory cache of the CFID doesn't reflect the new thing that has gone in the table, which means you're going to get a bunch of couldn't find CFID exceptions in logs, and eventually the node will crash. Column add and removes are okay, but renaming tables is not, because that will change the CFID. There is no good fix around this, but this is a known problem in community, so the new storage engine in 3.0 should fix this. In our case, we simply don't rename tables. We just create new tables and migrate data. Yep.
It's still a problem.
Oh, it is? Okay, it's good to know. SS table corruption. So as Azure is moving nodes around, sometimes it's also possible that your SS tables will get corrupt, because the node will simply go down while Cassandra is trying to write to file system and so on. This will show up as the corrupt SS table exception, and it clearly tells the name of the SS table, so it's somehow intuitive to figure out which SS table has gone bad. And the node won't start because generally we set the disk failure policy to zero. We've observed that node-tool scrub usually doesn't fix these SS tables, so we literally just run the command on the slide to get rid of those SS tables and run repairs so that our cluster is consistent. Even with reasonable tuning, our nodes were showing mutation drops. And as we started digging deep into code, we found out that this piece of code, local mutation runnable thread, it wasn't getting scheduled to run in the allotted time. So we contributed a few things back to the Cassandra code base as part of digging this deeply. So the first one is we exposed a metric. So we now tell how many drop mutations and drop messages are happening on a per table basis. And we also expose a metric that shows how much longer did that node take to process that mutation when it decided to drop it. So when you want to change your read and write timeouts, you know how much more you need to give to the node so that it can actually process it. So both of those metrics should now be available in 2.1 versions. We also found out that mutation and counter mutations were using the same thread pool, meaning they were starving each other. So we fixed that too. So again, that's in 2.1. Backup restore is another interesting thing for us. With replication factor of 5 and terabytes of data, we need an efficient way to do backups and restore. We explored using a dedicated data center with replication factor 1 as our backup data center, but we quickly found out that restore was painfully slow. So we built a rsync-based solution. So what this does is on every node, we have attached one more 1 terabyte hard disk, and it constantly takes snapshots and copies stuff over to that node. It also lets us restore in a staged fashion, and we built a tool. It's available on GitHub. What that lets you do is when you're restoring, you can start all the nodes. They can start taking live traffic, and you can restore back while they are taking live traffic. So we have to play with the SS table names. The SS table names don't have GUID, so we have some logic in there to make sure that we don't overwrite old SS tables by mistake. So if I have to summarize these takeaways at a high level, what would they be? So the first would be don't underestimate the learning curve. So teach, coach, grow, help, and whatever synonym you can find for this in thesaurus to your team members. We put together things like there's a link to a quiz. So that has around 50 questions that asks deep questions about Cassandra and how it works. And that has helped internally for our teams. It has questions like if a write request comes with a local quorum and if you get a failure on read, would you get old data, would you get latest data, does it matter what node the request hits, those kinds of things. We also debug multi-node Cassandra clusters locally on our dev boxes regularly. It's pretty easy to do, and it gives you a lot of good insights into the code. And the Jira and mailing lists are fantastic. The core Cassandra devs are really great at explaining issues deeply. You can also find some great workarounds there. So the ticket that I posted there is about when you remove nodes from a ring, they still stay in gossip and cause all kinds of bad things. So that ticket has a good workaround on how to fix that. Looking forward, we are looking at Azure Premium Storage to solve our SSD issues. So what this is network-attached SSD storage, but this also gives you local SSD cache. And on the beefiest SKU, this local SSD cache is around 550 gigs. This has great IOPS and latency if you raid disks, and there are some formal performance numbers. The links are up there. We have added these VMs to our existing clusters, and we haven't seen any performance degradation, but we are still working through specific experiments. So maybe next year when I come here, all of our clusters would be migrated to this, and we would be able to give you better numbers. That's all. Questions? So the question is, I talked about corrupt SS tables, and how is the question, how do we find out which SS tables are bad? Yeah, so it's actually in the logs. So the corrupt SS table exception clearly tells you which file is bad. And once you fix those, you keep restarting the process and eventually get out of this bad situation.
So that's parsing the logs.
Exactly, yeah. Yep.
I missed the part that, are you implementing in multi-region now, or is it a single region?
So right now it's still a single region, single physical region.
Private IP?
Yeah, it is private IP and single region. So the question is more elaboration on Spark and Cassandra, and why do we have 30 gig heap sizes? So yes, so because we have Spark and Cassandra running on the same node, we do want big heaps. So we went with 30 gigs. So we use, again, the question is how do we handle GC? So we use G1 GC, and it's been working great for us. So in the in our initial clusters, we didn't use G1, and that was a problem. But with G1 GC and 30 gig hips, we really haven't seen any long GC pauses. Yeah, the question is multi-DC on the roadmap? Yes, absolutely, it is on the roadmap, and we absolutely need that. Right now, we don't have, we're still exploring some options on how to get good networking in a multi-DC setup. So that's on our roadmap for next year. We definitely need that. Yep.
I was just curious, how did you eventually solve your problem with schema corruption when, you know, people make schema changes when nodes are down, say in a multi-tenant cluster?
So the question is, how did we eventually solve the schema corruption issues in a multi-tenant cluster? So right now, our clusters are not multi-tenant. And as I said, we really didn't solve the schema corruption problem. When we want to rename the tables, we create new tables and we migrate the data over. That's our poor man's way of solving it, but it works. So. So the question is, when we move to premium storage, would we reduce the replication factor to a smaller value? So the answer is yes, absolutely, because it gives better reliability. Right now, the replication factor is 5 because it's also a function of the pager duty. With 5, we can have 2 nodes down. So it's sort of related. Right, so the question is, the issues that I mentioned here, are they more specific to Azure, or are they specific to Cassandra? So I don't think there's anything specific to Azure here as such, because as we are running these nodes in cloud, no matter what cloud you pick, the nodes will go down and you need to handle those cases. And the issue of backup, again, it has nothing to do with Azure. It's a very common problem in big clusters. And I, as far as I know, I don't think there is a great solution in the Cassandra world for backup and restore yet. Right, any more questions? All right, thank you, everybody.